Padapadme Tayosritva Pranamami Mahurmuhu Namasri Yatirajaya Vivekananda Suri Satchit Sukhasvarupaya Swamine Tapahari. Revered and dear monks, devotees, and in particular, former Shari, who is on the dais, who gave such a beautiful talk. Swamiji, after the consecration of Belur Math, said that the spiritual wave emanating from this place will inundate the world for 1500 years. Have we seen such a wave sweeping humanity? Maybe not to that extent. It's hardly 120 years since Swamiji made that remarkable statement or prediction. We are already hearing rumblings of the rising of such a wave. One of the purposes of an avatara is to leave behind a wonderful new ideal before humanity, a very wonderful and adorable form. Of course, it's again based on the Sanatana Dharma, but it is an amount of newness or a new idea, something which people can really relate to, and that is one of the real purposes of avatara. Otherwise, you know, in Gita it is said that Vidagidagi dharmasya gandhi bhagati bharata gitanam dharmasya tadarpanam sriyamam paritranaya sadhunam nasaya krishna dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavam yukyam. He is coming to again for re-establishment of dharma. That means it's not anything totally new. It's based on the Sanatana Dharma, but there is a certain amount of a newness, a new idea, a new shade, a new variety, a new ideal, along with a wonderfully adorable form. Swamiji says, but take it from me, never did come to this earth such an all-perfect man as Ramakrishna. Such a unique personality, such a synthesis of the utmost jnana, yoga, bhakti and karma has never before appeared among mankind. Such a perfect character is the ideal of this age. So when we see that a new spiritual way for the modern world, yes, it's a spiritual way, but I think that is better understood as a new ideal which would really move the world, motivate mankind to once again their spiritual ideas and spiritual ideals. Now when we say an ideal, ideal is often and clearly understood as a symbol of perfection. Through ideal, we attain to the perfection, getting rid of all imperfections. There's a freedom from bondage, absolute fearlessness, knowledge and joy of the highest order. All these are all possible according to our ancient scriptures and the ancient wisdom in our Vedanta. It's all possible only by a realization of the knowledge of the highest order, namely the knowledge of the Brahman, the Advaita knowledge of the highest order. But what happens to such a personality once he becomes a knower of Brahman? Brahma Veda Brahmaiva Bhavati. A knower of Brahman becomes verily the Brahman himself or Brahman itself. How does such a Brahmagyani relate to the world? How does the world appear to him? That's a very important question. And that is where Sri Ramakrishna has really given a new dimension to this understanding by his own life. The traditional idea of Brahmajnana was you negate everything. Using the path of neti-neti, you reach the highest knowledge of the Supreme Brahman. In fact, even at advanced stages of such a search, you completely dissociate yourself from the world itself. And once you realize the highest knowledge, you are completely away from the world. Because by that time, the world is absolute mithya, is a total non-entity for you, is absolutely irrelevant for you. But Sri Ramakrishna brought about the concept of Vijnana. He said that the same highest truth can also be realized using the path of affirmation. Iti, iti, iti. Not only that, he said, the difference between a Jnani and a Vijnani has been very beautifully portrayed, put forth by Sri Ramakrishna. He said that it's like climbing a flight of stairs with the knowledge that the stairs are not the terrace, going to the terrace, and after experiencing the joy of standing on the terrace, while coming down, you affirm that the steps are also made of the same material as the terrace, namely cement, bricks, etc. So this he called Vijnana. The Vijnani. What is the difference between a Jnani and a Vijnani? Sri Ramakrishna himself says that there are two kinds of Jnanis. One like who eats the mangoes and wipes his mouth. There are other kinds of Jnanis who share the fruit with others. They come back to the world, live in the world, allowing the grace of grass to flow through them, and they are a blessing to humanity. So Sri Ramakrishna was perhaps the foremost example of this second type of Jnani, that is Vijnani. So you know, because of this, it's possible for all spiritual aspirants to relate to Sri Ramakrishna and to relate to the world itself, because you no longer have to completely give up the world that way. We'll come to that a little later. But then, how can Sri Ramakrishna, who spent all his life virtually as a complete renunciate, was far away from anything remotely worldly, who spent his time only in God consciousness, how can be an ideal, a role model for this, the world of today, which is steeped in materialism, consumerism, there's a tremendous amount of competition, violence, and so on and so forth. It's possible because the world itself, the trends are fast changing. Because of the globalization, barriers are breaking and people all over the world are able to access so much of information, so much of knowledge, pick up wherever, whatever they like, whatever they feel, convenient for them, suitable for them. So this has also resulted in upsurge of spirituality or spiritual pursuit to a great extent, and there is a tremendous interest in meditation all over the world. Several universities abroad have regular serious sessions on meditation. Even today corporates are talking about a spiritual orientation towards management. You know, if you, I don't know, you have heard of the book American Veda by an author by name Goldberg. He has clearly pointed out in his beautiful book how Vedanta has practically permeated every aspect of society in America. He says in malls, in concerts, in coffee houses, in corporates, everywhere, you can clearly see that it's ultimately the thought of Vedanta that's a very dominating influence or force there. So you know, this idea has also given rise to a kind of a new group of people, because the earlier there is a huge barrier between science and religion. These were considered compatible. Today, you know, it is changing, and The religion also is aligning itself to science in many ways. In fact, great scientists like Roger Penrose and others have done a lot of work, research on consciousness itself. So the distinction between science and religion is also getting erased to some extent, in the sense that both are accepting certain fundamental principles. Apart from all that, today there is a global community which is emerging, which calls itself as spiritual but not religious. They no longer like to be confined to the walls of a system or a monastery or an idea or a culture or a cult. They don't want to be tied down by all that, but they would like to pursue a spiritual goal without really being bogged down by such barriers or such constraints. So, you know, a kind of a loose movement which is not, you know, bound by any such constraints or limitations, but, you know, spread all across the globe, is fast emerging. People who are deeply interested in spiritual life. Then, you know, that also takes us to the discussion, what exactly is meant by spirituality? Spirituality, spiritual means concerning the spirit and not material, not matter, which is of the nature of transcendence, is beyond senses. No, it's an idea of ultimate, an idea, a view of reality and a way of life, you may see that. So, you know, this ultimate idea beyond senses, oneself as a spirit, is what we can briefly describe as a spiritual ideal or a spiritual orientation. So, you know, tremendous interest is seen in these ideas all over the world. People who are not linked to any formal religion. In fact, formal religions are slowly, you know, giving way to these kind of movements where a large number of people, not being specifically aligned or attached to any particular cult or that kind of a religion, but yet are showing tremendous interest in spirituality as such, they are the people who are really, you know, coming forward. They are increasing in numbers and so on. So, you know, that also takes us to the view how this kind of a spiritual orientation, that kind of a spirituality, where does it draw sustenance from this Ramakrishna ideal? Where does Ramakrishna give them that kind of a support? Again, you know, as we briefly touched earlier also, Sri Ramakrishna's view of the world, I think, you know, maybe here and there he might have mentioned, but largely, Sri Ramakrishna never used to encourage or discuss largely the idea the world is a myth or world is a maya. Of course, he was very much aware, and he constantly emphasized the impermanence of the world, anityata, but he never said that it is absolutely, you know, maya or unreal in that sense. On the other hand, he had a different way of approaching the world. So he said that, you tell the devotees, you don't have to give up the world. I have burnt myself drink to such excess. You don't have to do that. Rather, being in the world and practicing spiritual disciplines, he would say, is like fighting from within a fort. You are protected on all sides. You don't have to go for begging your food here and there. Your daily needs are taken care of, and you can really call on God or pursue that you really mean most to your life. So, you know, he says this idea, again is a very beautiful idea, where he says that you don't have to completely negate the world. He himself, you know, after all his realizations, he came back, he lived in the same place, the same Dakshineswar, he met the same people also, he went all over Calcutta, but the whole thing was, his vision was totally different. Because as Revered Swami Atmakriyanji also put it, Drishtim Yanamim Kritva Pashya Brahmamayim Jagat. He saw, instead of Brahman, he only called this as the Divine Mother. He saw the presence of Divine Mother everywhere. Also, he used to say, Kholtike Janva Chaitanya Ukhi Marche. The consciousness is peeping out from the pillowcases.
So you know, he saw the same Calcutta, the same people, all that was there before, but then his whole vision was totally different. So he would see the presence of the Divine Mother everywhere, and that is how he could relate to the world. So you know, in a small way, people may not be able to perceptibly, tangibly, really see the Divine Mother everywhere. But then, you know, taking a cue from Sri Ramakrishna's life, probably a different outlook, different attitude towards the world itself may be much more elevating and ennobling. And that would give a sanction for people to live, pursue their own pursuits, and at the same time aspire for something really spiritual or transcendental. Otherwise, you know, in the traditional Advaita, if you take to deep sadhana, there was no alternative. Either you accept the world and be part of it, or completely give it up and take to this world of world negating sadhana. But Sri Ramakrishna was extremely considerate. He said that, see, even if you have to eat, even if the desire to eat something, offer it to God and take it as his or her prasada, as a sacred food or sanctified offering. So you know, he brought a new outlook on the world. Thereby, you can live in the world, you can pursue the apparently existential pursuit, and at the same time, tune yourself, turn your mind towards God. It's possible. You know, in that sense, the idea of seeing God everywhere, Swamiji later on made that great proclamation, each soul is potentially divine, the goal is to manifest this divinity. And you know, this is the, and attain to freedom, this is the whole of religion. He said you can take any one of the paths and yet reach that goal. But then again, this is again what he learned at the feet of Sri Ramakrishna. When he wanted, Sri Ramakrishna asked him, what do you want to become? He said, I want to remain deeply absorbed in samadhi, come down once in a while to have a morsel of food for the sustenance of the body, and then again dive deep into samadhi. Sri Ramakrishna was not happy. Any other guru would have danced, but he said, what a small minded person you are. I thought you would become a huge banyan tree under the shades of which thousands of scorched souls would take shelter. You are thinking of your own mukti. Don't you sing that song, Jo kuch hai so tu hi hai? Whatever you see in front of you is the veritable manifestation of God. I think you know this idea. That's what Swamiji later on translated when he also gave that twin ideals before the order, the Ramakrishna movement, Atmana Mokshatam Jagat Hitaya Cha, through Jagat Gita. He made it an extraordinary part of spiritual striving or sadhana. In the earlier system, in the earlier tradition, you have to give up the world, you cannot have anything. Karma, work itself means bondage or ashakti, and that will pull you down, take you away from your ideal. But in this new idea, the work, the karma can be a wonderful way of your going forward in your spiritual pursuit. He said that, as Thakur said, Shri Gyan Se Jeev Seva, service of God in man. Swamiji made it as an integral part of this Ramakrishna movement. And he said that through this, it's possible for you to go forward in your search for the ultimate or search for the reality. So you know, in his that famous statement, each soul is potentially divine. One of the very powerful ways of going forward in the search for this manifestation, this potential divinity, is through service of God in man. So thereby, you know, it's possible that every endeavor in this world can be linked to a spiritual ideal. You don't have to straight away give up anything or turn your face away from the world. Rather, you can participate in a very beautiful way and at the same time slowly march towards the highest goal of life. So you know, that is why this idea of service that has gained such a prominent place in the scheme of things in the Ramakrishna movement, has been not only our centers, even the other private ashramas, wherever we have this Ramakrishna Bhavapacha Sanghatans, everywhere, you know, the seva activity is made part of that. You know, Swamiji saw that this new ideal for the mankind, new ideal for the world itself, not only India, even in other countries also, in other places also, this has found a very beautiful acceptance. Because, you know, Swamiji through his Bharat Parikrama, when he went on the parikrama of India on foot, he saw that this country, which is so rich in spirituality, but is steeped in darkness, mired in poverty and illiteracy and also superstition. He said, there was something needs to be done. And he said, the people who can really do this are those who are really oriented towards a deep sense of spiritual pursuit, because they would not aspire for anything for themselves, rather they would be willing to work for others, do something for the regeneration or the betterment of humanity. That is why what was in the olden days was thought of as a great sense of bondage. People were advised to keep away from it. Swamiji converted it into a beautiful instrument which would take us forward in our spiritual journey. That is why in this new idea, a new spiritual way, there is a wonderful combination of jnana, bhakti, yoga and karma, and that's one of the special features of this new way. Because earlier this jnana and karma were considered completely incompatible, and not only that, even jnana and bhakti also have to separate at some stage. But whereas in this new idea, all these have been combined beautifully and given in a form which is acceptable to the entire mankind. You know,